I'm Kevin Graham and welcome to A Celtic State of Mind. Today I'm joined by Martin Donaldson and writer, spoken word director and Celtic fan Kevin P. Gildey. Kevin, how are you getting on?
I'm doing okay, how are yous?
Not too bad,
good,
not
thanks.
Too bad.
Good, good.
First question we ask everybody.
Aye.
Who is your Celtic team?
Who's my Celtic team? You know, the first team that I remember, like I was kind of always taken to Celtic matches when I was wee. But I think I didn't quite have the attention span for it. Do you know what I mean? My dad says that he remembers taking me to games in the jungle, and I'd just sit there and kind of I'd be looking forward to a goal, not because it was exciting or anything, but because there was like the scoreboard and it had the big horns clapping, which I thought was magic as a child. So yeah, I was always at games, but the first team that I remember properly feeling like I had a proper affinity with and feeling like I followed it all the way was definitely Tommy Burns' team, definitely the Three Amigos, etc. And I think I was just at the right age. Just, you know, we were playing football at school and, you know, my auntie and uncle had Sky Sports, so we could see the games at their house. And I just remember those seasons and how amazing it was and how, for the first time, it felt like I was kind of included and it felt like it was exciting. And I remember watching a few games and it was the first time I really got it, I think, and I really kind of fell in love with it properly. So
such a good team to actually get.
Aye.
A team that's fondly remembered even though they never achieved
even though they're
what we wanted them to achieve. And
yeah,
we're lucky enough to bump into some of the players for that team, eh, Martin?
Yep,
like Jackie, Sid, Tom Boyd and that.
Yeah, yeah.
And they're sometimes held further in regard than some of the teams that actually achieved stuff.
They actually won stuff,
Especially, can anybody name the League Cup winning team 2000 when Barnes got sacked?
Aye.
And maybe Aberdeen in the final. And you go, who was in that team?
But
we can remember the Three Amigos.
But there was something about that time, it was just quite something a wee bit romantic about it, I think. It felt
definitely
quite special, and I remember really specifically, was it a Boxing Day game against Aberdeen, and De Canio scored, and he was wearing, you know, these details you remember as a child, he was wearing golden boots, and it was amazing. And they're the kind of things, especially when you're a kid and you're at a formative age, they just really stick with you.
What's your thoughts on De Canio now?
Here
we go.
Obviously, you get older and you start to learn about politics and you start to learn about his politics and his past and where he kind of falls in that political spectrum. And I have no love for him whatsoever, to be honest.
Well, I'm a bit torn. I don't agree with his political views whatsoever.
Uh-huh.
But we've had Jenna Burns, Tommy's daughter, in,
mm-hmm.
and she says what he done for Tommy.
Yeah,
and at that time he was such a gentleman. So I'm kind of torn.
It's hard to reconcile those two things, isn't it?
Definitely.
Yeah.
I just see him as a football player, and
uh-huh.
he was a good person to people that I know.
Of course. I suppose it's kind of, you know, who you are and where you're from and how you're brought up. If you're brought up with that kind of mindset, then maybe that's you and you kind of carry it with you throughout your life, even if you're a nice person. But I find that hard to deal with, especially with Celtic being a political
definitely
club and the politics being right at the fore of everything. To have somebody like that associated, I couldn't see him doing a half-time draw, do you know what I mean?
No, definitely not. I don't think he would be welcome back at Celtic Park, and which is maybe unfortunate, but the whole Lazio thing recently has,
that just brought it all back
up and also put our support in a good light.
Mm-hmm.
We're now the poster boys for left-wing fans all over Europe.
Loved it. I was at the game, and every time a banner came out, I was like, this is magic. This is exactly what I want. This is exactly, you know, because when your politics aligns with the politics of your team, then you're like, this is just great. Mm-hmm. I feel so bad for people who support other teams, and, you know, they maybe have their own political thoughts, and then they go to a game and they're surrounded by people chanting the absolute opposite. It must be horrible. So it's really great to go to Celtic Park and see that kind of stuff happen.
There is, we're not going to say everybody in the Celtic support has the same political mindset as three years in this room.
Uh-huh.
Because I've heard some horrible things mm-hmm. at Celtic games.
Yeah, yeah.
And I know, have known Celtic fans who have got completely different political views from me. I know some that wouldn't shy away from saying racist comments. And you're like, well, I didn't agree, but they are Celtic fans. But I think it's a Celtic state of mind. The majority of Celtic fans have got a certain left-wing view on things.
Yeah, and that's built into who you are as a Celtic fan, I think. I always find it mad. I'm like, how's this guy a Celtic fan and a Tory? How's that possible?
The MP for this area? Or soon to be ex-MP for this area?
Good. But you go, how is that possible when the whole club is built on this ethos and it's built on this history, to then support a political party that's kind of doing the exact opposite in society? Mm-hmm. It's madness. Aye.
Where did you grow up?
So I grew up a place called Millerston in the east end of Glasgow. Kind of round about, kind of steps, Huginfield Loch, near that kind of area. So yeah, east end of Glasgow. So it was good, you know. It was like Celtic was my local team. It wasn't too far away to get down to Celtic Park, and yeah. I think it was a nice place to grow up and be part of all that as well.
So, who took you to the games?
My dad took me to the games, as usual, as these things always are. I think with my generation, it was my dad that took me. And yeah, he took me when I was a kid, right the way through. I think I went to a few away games as a kid as well, which I have absolutely no memory of, apart from being in a supporters bus on the way back from Kilmarnock or somewhere. And everybody being absolutely fully on the bus, just absolutely. And nowadays you'd be like, you can't leave a kid with these people. But they didn't care. My dad was pissed. Everybody was drunk. And there was a, you know, kind of police guy on a motorbike up the side of the bus. And obviously I'm a kid and I've been taught, oh, if you see a policeman, you wave at him. So I wave at this policeman and he waves back. And all of a sudden, half the bus is out at the windy, giving him the vickies and shouting at him through the windy. So I remember those kind of things fondly.
They're brilliant, eh? Great memories.
Great memories.
I said, no memories of the game or anything, but aye.
Brilliant memories. And coming from the East End of Glasgow, you've already laid your political outlook on the line. And you're a writer and a spoken word artist.
Mm-hmm.
So, how did a wee laddie for the East End of Glasgow end up?
I'm still not sure, to be honest. I don't know how that happened. You know, I went to uni in Stirling, which was a big change for me. I didn't think, you know, nobody in my family had ever been to uni before, and it was a bit of a weird thing for me to go. And I kind of stayed up here in Stirling for a few years, and I think it kind of opened my world view a wee bit. Also, I was just really into music. Like, I was in a band when I was in high school and stuff. So I went to high school in Cumbernauld, and I think for like fourth, fifth year onwards, we were in a band. I mean, we were awful, rotten, absolutely rotten. But,
who did you sound like?
Oh, sounded like a mixture of like At The Drive-In and The Clash or something. Like it was awful. Although I was trying to sing like Morrissey or the top of it as well, so it wasn't a great mix of influences.
There we go, we've got a podcast that's mentioned De Canio and Morrissey.
But yeah, so I've played in bands all the way through uni, graduated, didn't really know what I was doing with my life, was working in call centres, still playing in bands, still making music, still not getting anywhere. And I started kind of reading out poems in between songs, because I was in this kind of slightly experimental band, and it was really great, and I was like, oh, I'm quite enjoying this. And then that band inevitably split up, and I was like, you know what, I'll just do the poetry stuff, I'll just do that myself, because I don't need a guitarist, I don't need a drummer, I don't need to carry any equipment. Mm-hmm. I just turn up with a bag full of poems and just start reading them at the mic, and that's it. And the minute I got into that, it just opened up for me, and I just really loved it. Started doing it as much as possible. And then I started getting bookings other places and started kind of doing it down south and then touring abroad, and it just kept on going for there. So my kind of answer to the question is, I don't know how it happened. It just happened. Aye. So I'm really thankful that it did, though, because it opened up loads of stuff for me, and I've met loads of great people through it. And then I've moved into writing kind of novels, moved into writing for TV, for theatre, and then performing theatre and doing all these mad things that I do with my life now that I had no idea I could do before now. So, it's quite exciting.
What did you study at uni?
I studied film and media studies.
Right, so...
Which is a surefire degree if you want to work in a call centre.
Was your dad creative, or any of your family creative? What we usually find when we speak to creative types with a Celtic state of mind, that they're sort of... Aye, my uncle always used to come round with a banjo. And, family parties used to be great.
There's always a wee bit of that, aye. My mum was a bit of a singer, and she always used to have the Patsy Cline records on. My dad was really into his music. He was big into his music. And I think when he was younger, he saw all the bands. Do you know what I mean? He was a big fan of the Stranglers and all that kind of stuff. So there was always really good music on. It wasn't a, I talked to my pals and they're like, oh yeah, we just listened to Michael Jackson. I was like, no. Like, we had the Smiths and the Police and stuff on in our house, and loads of Deacon Blue and all these weird old jazz and blues records and stuff. And so I feel like there was part of that seeped in. And also, just that weird Scottish Glasgow thing, that one singer, one song, everybody gets drunk at a party and starts singing tunes. And I think being around that when you're a child, you kind of go, oh, I'd quite like that. And I was always into singing when I was a kid as well, so it always made sense for me when I was a wee bit older to join bands and do all that stuff and try and do it professionally, which never quite happened, but now I'm here, so...
You're still in a band, eh? The Glasgow Cross.
So it's kind of went full circle a wee bit, because I've ended up making music again and singing in a band again. But that ended up I was working with this guy Ralph, who's an amazing musician. He owns his own record label. And I was working with a band that he was in, and we got along really well. So I ended up kind of doing this collaboration with him, and then he basically composed pieces of music that would go with my poems, which was amazing. And then we started kind of performing it live, and then we really liked it, and I was like, let's write some actual songs, because I'd like to get back to doing that and actually performing live again as a singer, so next year, hopefully the album will be out with some actual songs on it, as well as some poems as well. So looking forward to that.
You says that you were doing poems in between the songs of your own band.
Yeah.
Do you still perform them now? Or are they completely binned?
But most of them are so bad that I wouldn't perform them now, to be fair. I think there's maybe one or two that's still a bit for that era that I would maybe do every now and then, but most of them were terrible. But a lot of it is still the same stuff I'm interested in just now. It's still stuff about Glasgow, stuff about society, stuff about inequality, stuff about, dealing with masculinity and dealing with kind of poverty and all these kind of pressures that we have in our lives, and how we kind of deal with those, and how we kind of make the best of it, and how do we change for the better, kind of a thing. So there's still a lot of the same themes that have ran through my work, and they come up in everything as well. They come up in the theatre stuff, and they come up in the, the scripts that I'm writing, and they're obviously coming up in the poetry and the music. So I feel like if somebody looked at all the stuff I'm doing, they'll be like, oh, you could see big themes emerging, the stuff that I'm really interested in and stuff that I want to talk about,
You've been 10 years doing the spoken word and that, because you recently released your book, Sad Songs for White Boys, which was a collection of 10 years worth of poems. Yeah. Was that you drawing a line?
It was definitely, actually. It was nice to have a chance to do that and have a book that just brought all that stuff together. Because it's loads of old stuff, some new poems, some poems that, maybe get published in a fanzine somewhere once and then disappeared. And it was great to kind of put them all together and go, oh, look at this, actually. It's quite a nice thing to look at 10 years of work and go, I done all right, and this is actually some decent stuff. And then to put it out into the world and go, right, that's it, though. That's gone. And let's draw a line there. And now let's start thinking about the next 10 years of work and what you're going to make in that time and how that's going to pan out and what you want to achieve during the next 10 years. So it was quite exciting, actually.
Was there any poems that you went back to and you edited?
There was, actually. There was a few that I went back to that was just... They weren't quite right. Weren't quite as good as I would like them to be, basically. I think I'm just better now than I was. I think every year I feel like I just get a wee bit better at it and I get a wee bit more confident and I know what... Basically, I just know what I'm doing a wee bit more because I never knew what I was doing to start with. I was just making it up as I was going along. Whereas now I'm like, this works because of this and I'll move this about here. And so revisiting the older stuff and then doing that and kind of giving that a new lease of life was actually quite a nice thing as well before sending it off on its way. Aye.
Do you find that, like, the stuff that you're doing, like you say, it's got obviously a kind of Glasgow society theme, yeah? When you're touring around, like if you're doing something in America or North America, do you feel you need to kind of temper that kind of stuff?
You know, I found it, they love it. I found it, they love that stuff. Like, I was in Bristol the other night doing a poem about Glasgow, and they were just loving it because it's a window into someone else's world. And as long as you maybe provide a wee bit of context, or you say, this is what this word means, because you don't know what this word means, then I think people are really up for that. I think they love kind of hearing something authentic. And it's authentic in terms of what I'm talking about. It's authentic in terms of the voice I'm using. It's authentic in terms of just the delivery of it, is the way I would say it. So I think that people really appreciate that. And, you know, done gigs in Germany when, you know, half the audience have, like, you know, no, like, amazing levels of English, but everybody still gets it and everybody still loves it and everybody still appreciates you kind of just going there and being yourself and sharing your work, aye.
The spoken word scene sort of exploded and there's a lot of voices there that they speak in their regional accents and they don't try to temper their regional accents. I think it gives it more passion.
Yeah.
And when you hear somebody reading something and they're trying to make it like more accessible to maybe an audience in London, for example, and I think it loses its appeal. Was that, have you ever thought about going, I'll need to change this?
Not really. I mean, every time I've kind of got a gig in London or somewhere like that, I've just went, they'll just need to deal with it. Do you know what I mean? It's because it's not my issue, it's their issue if they're not able to follow me. I've had people saying, can you slow down? And I was like, no. you can keep up if you want, but I'm not going to slow down. But that's just the way it is. But I think poetry's great for it because see if you're going to stand up on a stage in front of a microphone and you don't have that kind of cover of somebody playing guitar and somebody playing drums beside you. It's just you with a microphone and your words and that's it. If you're going to be brave enough to do that in the first place, then why would you hide behind, you know, putting on a voice? It's your voice, so you might as well be completely and utterly raw and unfiltered and just be yourself and just say what you need to say. And I think that's really exciting, actually. I love doing that, and I love kind of standing up in front of an audience and just seeing where it goes and just kind of, giving them a show, basically.
It's a buzz, eh? Especially going somewhere where nobody knows you.
Honestly, it's like, and people don't understand. People are like, oh, you go to poetry reading, and like they think that I'm going to sit on stage with a book and there's 10 people like stroking their chins, and it's like, man, it's like big theatres and there's like, you know, back rooms of pubs. It's like, it's got a punk aesthetic now, it's got a punk ethos. People are doing it themselves and it's amazing.
Last night I was in Greenock, the Greenock Celtic Supporters Club, and it was a question and answer session with John Hartson.
Yeah.
And I went on during the break and done three poems.
Amazing.
To 200 people who are there to listen to John Hartson.
They're the best audiences. See the people that aren't expecting it. Love it. I've done gigs like that before where I'm kind of in between other people that they're there to see, basically. Do you know what I mean? Or I'm the support act for somebody who's doing well and their audience is there. And I just love the people because they're not expecting it. They're not expecting to hear poetry that actually has some kind of effect on them and has some kind of connection with them.
Definitely.
So it's amazing to go out there and do that and kind of surprise people with it. And I think it opens it up to them because they go, oh, maybe this poetry's all right. Because people are so put off with the poetry they're made to listen to and read in school. Do you know what I mean? I think loads of people just have that in their head and that's them kind of for life. They go, no, poetry's awful.
Have you found that a working class guy for Glasgow when you've been going down south or anywhere? Has there been any, like, people going, why are you doing this?
I don't think anyone's been quite as blatant to say that, but I think that there's definitely that undertone sometimes of you're doing well for yourself, ain't you? And it's like, actually, I've been working really hard for 10 years, but, you know, people think that you've just kind of, you're there because you're a demographic and you're making up the numbers kind of a thing. It's like, actually, I've got 4 books, you know what I mean? Give us a break. I'm, like, trying my best here. And I think that there's definitely that thing of people are expecting you to maybe know, be as intelligent or as well-spoken as you are, do you know what I mean? And it's like, you can use your own accent, but it doesn't stop you having a massive vocabulary and phrasing things in an interesting way and saying lines that move people, do you know what I mean?
And I think when you look at the spoken word scene, we first started talking.
Yeah, yeah.
I jumped into a conversation you were having with Matt Abbott.
Yeah, yeah.
Who's from Leeds, I think is.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
We were talking about Mark Viduka.
Uh-huh.
And Matt's a working class guy for Leeds.
Yeah.
And you've got people like Kate Tempest, Victoria McNulty from Glasgow as well.
Aye.
And the guy Jamie for Derby.
Oh, Jamie, yeah, Frisavolo.
I
always struggle, yeah. But yeah, there seems to be a kind of emerging kind of scene of these spoken word poets who, as you said, regional accents, saying things that they want to say, but also it's politics today as well. It's like people are just talking about what's happening and what they're feeling and how kind of helpless it all is just now, but also the effects that we're seeing in everyday life, do you know what I mean? It's a time where it's like, it's worrying, but it's also a great time to be an artist and kind of speak up and say what it is you want to say.
You also run Nights in Glasgow, which have got a fantastic name, yes. Sonnet Youth.
Yes.
How did you come up with that name?
Honestly, I don't know. I think it just came to my head one day and I thought, I'm keeping that. I kept it in my back pocket for a good 2 years or something before the chance to do some regular shows came up. And then that was me. I was like, okay, this is what we're calling it. So, yeah, it's me and my creative partner, Kat Hepburn. So we both run the shows and we book it. And then we host it and we do some of our own stuff. And we just arranged the whole thing, basically. But and loads of the amazing poetry that I'm talking about, but mixed up with a wee bit of comedy, because we love a bit of comedy and we don't want too much poetry. Usually a wee bit of music and some weird stuff as well. Sometimes some rappers, some kind of cabaret acts. Just any weird stuff that we see and we go, this is great, get this booked.
You've had some big names at your night, say Darren McGarvey, Loki.
We've had Darren on and Rab Florence with Burniston and like a few kind of people that I always say people off the telly. A few people off the telly.
What's the reaction like being to the nights? Did they sell out?
I mean, they've been doing well. They've been growing pretty steadily. It started off as just a kind of poetry night at the Drygate Brewery once a month, and then we moved through to Edinburgh, so we're doing 2 shows. Now we've got 3 shows a month, and we've moved the Drygate into the old hairdressers in Glasgow. So hopefully being in a more central location will help people come and see it as well. But people love it. I think people come along for maybe the comedy bit or maybe the music bit, and it's what we were saying. They get caught unawares by the poetry, and they go, oh, that's great as well. Or maybe they come for the poetry and they don't know anything about the comedy scene in Glasgow and then they end up seeing, you know, an amazing stand-up who blows them away and they go, that's amazing, I'm going to go to their fringe show. So it's this great way for artists to be kind of connecting with each other and connecting with new audiences, because it's never the same audience all the time, you know. It's never just a poetry audience or just a music audience or just a theatre audience. It's always a weird mix of people that come along, which is how we like it.
You mentioned a fringe, and yes. Now I follow you on social media, and you've been very, very vocal about your experience of the fringe this year.
Yeah.
So your show was called Suffering from Scottishness.
That's right.
And it got very good reviews. Unfortunately, I didn't get to make it to see it myself, no, but I think you're going to take it on tour. You're going to bring it
so.
For an outsider looking in, we mm-hmm. see the fringe as this fabulous,
of course,
jamboree of culture and arts. What's it like actually being inside that hurricane?
It's a fucking disaster. It's awful. I'm kidding on that. So much of it is amazing. So much of it is what you think it is. It's you're getting to do your show every day to a new audience. I mean, if you're lucky, you get an audience. And you're getting to see all your pals' shows as well. And all these people from all over the world taking their amazing show to Edinburgh, and you get to go see it. There's something incredible about that. What people don't understand is just how the finances work mm-hmm. and just how hard it is financially to put on a show. I mean, yeah, I lost over a grand, and that's not unusual. Most people lose more than that, which... I get some people go, oh, but look what you got. You got all these 4-star, 5-star reviews for papers and stuff, and people know who you are, and all these people came to your show, raises your profile. It's like, that's fair enough, but how do you do that every year unless you're rich? Mm-hmm. Unless you're well off, unless you come for money and you can go, I'm going to lose $2,000 every year, $3,000 every year to boost my profile on a yearly basis. I would love to do that, but I don't have $3,000 to lose every year. That's mental.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that because of that, what you get is it's a middle class festival full of middle class people who can afford to lose money, and you're no getting working class artists coming through and doing their show. Because it's impossible. How does somebody who doesn't have any savings pay for all the upfront fees? It's just impossible. So they end up, maybe if they're lucky, they might do the free fringe, but you're in a basement somewhere with no tech and no reviewer will ever come to see you. So it's a really hard shift. And I think that people don't really realise that that's how it works, that that you need to have this massive chunky cash up front, and then you need to be able to be capable of losing money, and then you need to just hope that you don't lose that much and you get enough to keep on doing it year after year.
Is that the same for any kind of arts festival, or is that like kind of specific around the Edinburgh one?
So some of them are the same, none of them are as bad. Basically, Edinburgh is the biggest rip-off out of all of them, but that's because it's the most money. It's the most money that's been made by people, and it's got the biggest profile, so they can afford to charge everybody. And these idiots are paying it, you know, people are paying it. And, you know, you don't hear Scottish accents in Edinburgh during the Fringe. All these guys are coming up for, you know, Cambridge fucking Drama Society and putting on their show, and it's like, there's no room. There's literally no room. In the sense of there's no spaces for working class shows to go on. And if you do find a space, if you do have a venue that's willing to take a risk on you, they're going to say, here, geez the money up front, geez this, you know, couple of grand, and then maybe try and make some money back from it. Even then, you're never going to do that without spending another grand or two on a PR person to go and get the reviews for you. The whole thing is set up so that everybody in Edinburgh makes money apart from the artists, which is just mind-blowing. Because that's the only reason anybody's there in Edinburgh in August, is to see the art. But the venues are making money, the producers are making money, the PR people are making money, the hotels are making money, the people with flats, making them Airbnbs, the restaurants, the pubs, everybody is making mad amounts of money, apart from the actual artists who are creating the work and doing it every day. And it's just... I know it's not going to change, but I like to moan about it.
It sounds like that kind of perfect crossover, though, between the arts, the theatre, and then football as well. The commercialisation there mm-hmm. is just
that's
pushed
it.
The kind of grassroots side of it completely out the side.
There is a parallel there, eh, when
of
you
course.
Actually see.
And I think the one thing right across it all is how do working class people get into it? How do working class people excel at something when they are being shut out because it's based on money?
So is that why Sonnet Youth, you created Sonnet Youth to give a platform to young working class?
That's it. As part of our remit, is we've got new artists on every month that we are introducing to people. We have probably the lowest kind of door entry fee. It's only a fiver in, and it's if you're unwaged or a student, it's only £3. So it's as accessible as we can possibly make it for people to come along and check out poetry. Because if you're going to the theatre, it's what, £15 a ticket. If you're going to a football match, what, 25 to, what did I pay the other day? 27, 29 quid for a ticket. And it's just hard. And it's hard for people, and people get less disposable income. And that's part of the ethos of Sonnet Youth, was open it up to as many people as possible to come and see something new, something that they might love. Because people might walk through the door and go, in fact, I love poetry now, and I'm going to go out and start writing my own. And in a couple of years, they might be back doing the introducing slot. And a year after that, they might be back being a headliner or a feature act. So it's an amazing thing, and we're really proud of what we're doing, and kind of opening it up and making it a wee bit more accessible and a wee bit more democratic for people, you know.
Rewind a wee bit to your stage show, Suffering for Scottishness.
Aye.
Can you tell us what that was about?
Oh, it was a mad concept show. So the idea was that sometime in the future, say post-Brexit, that Scotland is still part of the UK, but we've been devolved all these powers, and one of the powers we've got is over citizenship. So we have to create our own citizenship test that people would take if they wanted to be a Scottish citizen. So it was a show where I was playing a character, and I'm kind of from the government, and I'm on stage and I'm saying, right, should we have a question about inventors in our Scottish citizenship test? And I'd do a wee bit about inventors, and the crowd all had these kind of cards that said aye or no. So they voted whether this question would be part of it or no. But the whole thing was just kind of taking apart Scottish identity and kind of working out a few things about myself, actually. I always wanted to write something about Scottish identity because I never really felt particularly Scottish as a child. Growing up, I never felt Scottish. I mean, the usual stuff, it was like, you know, I had Republic of Ireland tops rather than Scotland tops. I think at one point I had two. I had both of them. And it's like, you know, you're never quite sure what you are. You had like a tricolour up in my room and stuff. And you're like, that identity, that split identity of being Scottish and what you think is Irish, but actually it's quite different. That weird kind of Scottish Catholic thing. I always kind of felt that was kind of ripe for getting into and kind of working out a wee bit and kind of talking about. So it was just a clever kind of staging way of for me to do that, basically. I mean, I should have just hired a psychiatrist, to be fair, but I thought I would just stay at the fringe instead. But but loads of people connected with it. And in fact, loads of people who are Celtic fans came along and they kind of really connected with it, because there was bits where I was talking about that, about, you know, no being allowed to wear a Scotland top as a kid, and, you know, that thing, can you watch Scotland on the telly? Are you still allowed to love them? Or do you have to do this thing over here? And then when you finally visit Ireland as an adult and you go, this isn't my country either, do you know what I mean? This is somebody else's country and I'm not quite supposed to be here either. I always found it really interesting, and how you're never quite any one thing if you grow up in a kind of, you know, Scottish, Catholic, Celtic supporting household.
I come from, my dad's family is from Donegal, but it's like great-grandfather.
That's it.
So it gets fed down. My dad married in a mixed family, Protestant. His family disowned him because he married him. So I always heard this, like, confusion. And I did support Scotland, but when it came to the World Cup, I remember World Cup Italia 90, celebrating big Packy Boners celebrating that. Yeah. When Scotland got beat with Costa Rica, I remember going into school the following day going, I'm Irish now. And it's true what you're saying there. I never saw myself as Scottish for years and years.
Yeah.
And it wasn't until the day after the referendum. It was the first time I ever felt Scottish.
That's actually, I mean, that's basically what the show's about, is the character. And the character is, you know, a version of myself, but the character is unsure of his identity up until that moment where he starts campaigning and he starts being part of the referendum campaign, which is kind of exactly what I'd done. I was always kind of quite ambivalent and definitely didn't count myself as nationalist in any way. Still, you know, quite problematic, all that stuff.
I still didn't.
Yeah, yeah. But, you know, that was a big moment and kind of feeling, oh, this is a kind of pivotal thing. I think it was just the idea that maybe if we'd won and if it was a yes vote, that the Scotland in the future could have been one that I helped build, or I could be something that had a different feeling to it and had a different kind of set of rules from what I had grown up in and was more open and more equal and all that kind of stuff. And I think it was the excitement of like, oh, Scotland could be better and I could be part of that was amazing. So the show's kind of about that as well.
And I think it was just one of the moments that I think it was the first time we were all asked that question.
Uh-huh.
Almost like, where do you see yourself?
Yeah.
And I mean, the movement at that time was just, it was something else to see it. And
it was optimistic.
It was.
Do you know what I mean? It was
positive.
Enthusiastic. And people were answering that question. They're going, Scotland could be great. Scotland could be open and inclusive, and it could be forward-thinking. It could be, you know, we look at some of the amazing advances in some of the Scandinavian countries and the way they are kind of doing things and the happiness index that they have. And instead, we're stuck with this shite. We're stuck with the absolute worst of the worst. And it's brutal. And it's brutal to feel that that juxtaposition between what we could have had and what we have now. It's so hard.
I'm still are that optimistic person.
Yes.
And that morning and that day after the independence referendum, it felt like people who I felt were Scottish were celebrating hatred, celebrating being mastered by somebody else.
Yeah.
And also the fear that they had of, that there was a lack of confidence. And and people who I thought were more Scottish than me, I went, you are not. This is where I came from, I says. And it was that day, I went, I feel actually more Scottish now than what I've ever done in my life. And I still do. But you mentioned in we're probably heading towards another independent referendum there. But I look at some of the people who are fronting it and some of the people you see on social media, and I'm going, I've got nothing in common with you whatsoever.
Bunch of nutcases, honestly. I mean, that was also part of what the show was about, was me saying to all the kind of independence people, all the big supporters, all the SNP people, that you've lost it, you've lost the plot. Because, you know, see if I hear one mere person say, we'll fix it after we're independent. It's like, no, fix the child poverty just now. Fix the drug problem just now. Don't wait until we're independent to do it. Don't be blaming the lack of independence on the lack of work that's going into these things and fixing these social problems. So, yeah, I mean, I basically wrote a show where everybody hated me, because anybody who is kind of unionist or kind of no-leaning came in and went, oh, this guy's banging on about independence, I hate him. And then all the yes-voting people came in and went, oh, this guy's giving us a hard time for no working hard enough, we hate him as well. So I get some mad reactions, like...
I think as well, the optimism comes from the fact that I want us in this room are open-minded. We are immigrants. We are descended from immigrants. And I think the day after the referendum, it was the people that weren't descended were very closed, came with a closed mind.
Uh-huh.
And I think that spooked me more than anything. And the snarling, the hatred, the triumphalism. And you're going, wait a minute, didn't they want that?
I mean, well, they got what they wanted, and look at the state yet. Do you know what I mean? It's awful, and it's closed off to the rest of the world, and it could get worse. Do you know what I mean? I mean, it will get worse after Brexit happens, but it's just an absolute disaster just now. But I think that's the only way to fight it, is to have that optimism, and is to have that thought of, in the future, this could be amazing. In the future, this could be better. I mean, perhaps not for us, but maybe the generation after that. But we could start building it just now. And I think we still need to hold on to that, even when it's as bad as it is just now. Do you know what I mean?
And it's no paint in your face and riding a motorbike round the George Square. Let's get a bit lighter, eh?
Okay.
Let's get a bit lighter. You're in the spoken word scene.
Yes.
All your time watching Celtic, have you ever went to, you ever looked at a player and went, I think he writes poetry?
Oh, that's a hard one, actually. You know, I always felt like, you know, when you kind of have a wee kindred spirit with people. I was like, Samaras definitely writes poetry. 100%. He's like, he's just got that kind of lethargic thing where he's like, he's obviously a very emotional human being, do you know what I mean? And it was like, and you could see it when he scored, he loved it, but you could also see it when he was getting a bad time, do you know what I mean? It was like his head would drop, and I was like, He's going to go home and write a wee sonnet about that later, do you know what I mean?
You can see him open night, Mike, doing the hugging pint.
Definitely. Well, like a wee turtleneck on. Aye, definitely. He had the hair for it as well and the beard, so it's all good.
I always got worried with Samaras when it got to the end of September and the snood appeared. and you just knew he would disappear until March, until the spring.
It's too cold for the football then, aye. I agree with him.
He was fantastic, though. He done a real good job for us.
Oh, I always like the players like that. I mean, I'm always on the side of the underdog, the weird players who kind of maybe don't get a shot all the time. And he was the classic. He came in and people were like, he's terrible, he's lethargic, he doesn't put in the effort. And then, you know, you saw when he scored those two goals at Ibrox, and when he jumped into the crowd and how much it meant to him, and I was like, nah, he's just a guy that feels it, do you know what I mean? But I've always loved, I always liked the obscure players. I remember, and this is mad, and people don't believe me when I tell them this, I had, like, the original kind of Bumblebee strip, the first one that came out, and I had O'Neill in the back for Brian O'Neill, and people were like, what? Do you know Ant? no offence to Brian O'Neill, by the way, but like people were like, do you know Ant? They have, you know, one of the other players, and I was like, no, I think I must have met him at like a, you know, signing at the Celtic shop or something. I was like, all right, he's my favourite now. Must have been the only person that had O'Neill in the back of his strip at that age.
That's quite strange, yeah, because I remember in the mid 80s living on Archdeacon.
Right,
I think it was maybe just his name. But I remember him, like, thinking, going, I like him, because he had kind of same sort of moppy hair as me. He was skinny, and I went, aye, if he can do it, I can do it. But never turned out
that's
that
it.
Way.
That's it.
Nah, sadly not.
You're touring Suffering with Scottishness next year.
Hopefully so. I'm trying to put it together just now. There's a chance there'll probably be at least a run of Glasgow shows, if not a full Scottish tour, which is the overall plan. And hopefully there'll be more stuff coming out next year as well. Hopefully another book, hopefully an album. Been doing some stand-up as well, so I might try my hand at a wee stand-up show. I'm actually doing a preview of my new stand-up show at the Glasgow Comedy Festival, so if people want to come along and check that out.
How can people find you?
It's on Facebook, Twitter, my website. So it's all just Kevin P. Gilday. So you can find me on the social media. My website's got all the live dates on it, so you can see where you can stalk me if you want to.
Maybe we'll get Samaras to stalk you.
Oh, I would love it.
Kevin P. Gilday with a Celtic State of Mind. Thank you very much.
Cheers, thank you.